morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Joe Piantedosi, representing the Patriotic Holiday Committee. On behalf of our committee, we'd like to welcome all of you here this, today to Veterans Memorial Park to help us celebrate Veterans Day. Before we get started, I'd like to say a few words about Veterans Day and our veterans. Veterans Day actually began a year after the armistice that ended World War I back in 1919. And back then it was called Armistice Day. Unlike Memorial Day, which honors our deceased veterans, Veterans Day is set aside to honor all veterans, and most importantly, to thank our living veterans who served honorably in the military in peacetime and wartime. And saying that, today is a special day for all the veterans who are here. Please raise your hands. On behalf of all of us, we want to thank you for your service, and I'd like to say that everybody here, if you haven't done it today, make sure you thank the veteran or veterans that you know. We have a number of special guests here today with us that I would like to recognize before we get started. We have members of our Veteran Select Board, Mike Rosenberg, Chair, Ed Pierce, Margaret Fleshman, Bill Moonen, and Emily Mitchell. We also have our State Senator, Michael Barrett, and our State Representative, Ken Gordon. We have an excellent group of speakers, five of them, so it's a busy agenda. And because it's a little chilly, I'm going to ask all of them to try and keep their comments as brief as possible, or they'll have to deal with my firing squad. Okay, at that, I'm going to invite John Cooper, our American Legion.
God, as we gather here in humble recognition of your divine providence, we beseech you to usher into our world of confusion and doubt the peace and tranquility which alone can come from you. Bless and protect our nation. Be merciful to our honored dead, the memory of whose valor, courage, and heroism inspires us to noble action and to eternal vigilance in the preservation of our noble action and to eternal vigilance in the preservation of our priceless liberty and our inalienable rights to enduring happiness. Guide and direct our minds to a thorough understanding of our duties to you, to our country, and to one another. Awaken in our hearts the desire and the will to accomplish the ideals for which this nation exists, so that out of our determination and endeavor there may emerge a better world, a world founded upon faith and understanding, a world dedicated to preserving the individual rights and dignity of man, a world of tolerance and justice, a world intent on loving and serving you, our Lord and Master. Amen. Cover.
Thank you.
Happy Veterans Day. A special shout out to Paul Perichia. Recover strong and soon, my friend. Most of you would agree, going to war is not one of the top items on anyone's bucket list. Let's go back to May 1940. Europe was savaged by war. 93% of the US was against entering. July 1940, 61% of the US was still against involvement. March 1941, slight change of heart. 67% thought it would be a good idea to at least help Europe out. Look off to the west there. A bronze statue depicting Captain John Parker carrying the first flag into battle of the Revolutionary War. Even during that time, however, no more than 30% of the colonists wanted war with England. Some things are worth fighting for. December 7, 1941, Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. Public sentiment shifted. An overwhelming 91% agreed with FDR's declaration of war against Japan. Since 9/11, many more have volunteered to serve, to sacrifice, and to defend. Not all veterans serve during war. Not all serve in combat. Veterans serve during peace as well. Each one of them took an oath without an expiration date. You know how it goes. To uphold and protect from foreign or domestic. You may have worn the uniform or not. That's super. Nowadays, only 1%, actually less than 1% do. I've got a few questions here for you to ponder, please. Ask yourself how a veteran might react to the likes of a New York Times article drawing attention to a TV station's choice of airing the national anthem to start off its daily broadcast. The article went on to say, "This overt allegiance to the Star-Spangled Banner has become one of the lines that separate blue and red America." Do you expect our World War II veterans, our national treasures, those even living over at the Bedford VA to agree with that sentiment? How about the constitutional right to burn a flag protected under the First Amendment? You think our all-volunteer force in today's military would agree? Let me make this crystal clear. Know this. Veterans may not agree with public sentiment one way or another. They are not politicians. Regardless if he or she agrees or disagrees, they fight to protect freedom for us all. Saying thank you for your service opens up a good dialogue. It's a beginning, yet sometimes words are never enough. This applies equally to the families of those who serve. In closing, remember the movie Saving Private Ryan? How at the very end, Tom Hanks portrayed Matt Damon as Private Ryan as he was scared and shaking. And Hanks grabbed him with his last breath, exclaiming, "Earn this." That poignant scene identifies the sacrifices brothers and sisters in arms make every day, and what they made on this mission to save or bring Private Ryan back home. An online saying caught my attention, echoing the power of Tom Hanks' character's last words. I leave with you what saying, what some may feel provocative. This, a call to action. If you really want to thank a veteran, be the kind of American worth fighting for. God bless all our veterans, especially those who continue to protect our freedoms with their courage, sacrifice, and unparalleled service.
Thank you, OC. Next, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Al Christholm, who's the Senior Vice Commander of VFW Post 1628.
Morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I like that. Always look for a response. I want to first thank all of those veterans and families and people who are serving, people who are about to serve, and anyone who supports the veteran, our veterans. So thank you for allowing me to serve for 27 years. When I was asked to speak this morning, I had a lot of thoughts that ran through my mind. What would I say to someone who is a veteran, who's friends of a veteran, family member of a veteran? What would I say to that person? Then I thought about my own career. I spent 27 years in the United States Air Force. Upon retiring, I found myself just across the hill over there at the VA Medical Center, where I was assistant to the chief medical officer. While I was there, I had an opportunity to share and exchange a lot of information between other veterans and myself. I immediately realized that we had a lot in common. I also realized that there were gaps in communication, things that we needed that we didn't have. One of my first initiatives as I drove around New England as a program manager, driving from Connecticut all the way to Maine, I recognized one flaw, and that was that the town of Bedford did not have a sign that said, VA Hospital, Bedford. I immediately contacted your congressman, Seth Pope. We began a dialogue about what we could do to improve communication here in Bedford. And I came up with an idea that we would put these signs along 128. So when you drive north and south on 128, you notice a sign that says, VA Hospital, exit 31B. I want you to know that came about just from one idea. I had discovered that there were even veterans who lived in Lowell, Massachusetts that did not know that they had a VA hospital in Bedford. So now, I have another challenge. As I thought about the service to our God and our country, and I even thought about my own wife, who spent 20 years in the Air Force, and 20 years working for DOD, and combined we have over 80 years of service. Once I retired from the VA, my thoughts didn't stop there. I found another gap. This time I'm bringing it to you. My thoughts are that we should establish a veteran news program through your local television addressing issues concerning veterans. We will invite those from the Veterans Benefits Association, Veterans Health Association, the Veterans Cemetery, and those three main agencies to address concerns. We would hope that you will help me organize this next event, this next plan for our future. I hope that you will join with me in making Bedford the first town in this Commonwealth that I know of that have a local program that's called Veteran News. We will invite others around the area to come and join us as guests as we present ideas and answer questions regarding veterans. Lastly, one driving force that caused me to come up with this idea is a time when I spent at my uncle's funeral. My uncle was a World War II veteran. He had been wounded in Pearl Harbor. And when everybody came back, Uncle Frank didn't. He was left in a hospital. Many years later, Uncle Frank began his life, got out of the military, and everybody noticed this big old hole that he had in his arm. He had not received any benefits, didn't know of any benefits. Until the day of his death, listening to his eulogy, I realized that there was a gap in communications. I ask you to join me as we close those gaps. May God bless you and your family, and thank you so very much for allowing me to serve this great country.
Thank you, Al, and I would like to introduce our next speaker, Mike Rosenberg, Chair of the Bedford Select Board.
Thanks, Joe. Just continuing on the theme that Al introduced, many of you have heard me expound on what I consider this town's unique military culture. I don't think there's any other place in the United States that hosts a Veterans Hospital on the north side, an active Air Force base on the south side, and a colonial heritage that connects us to one of the world's most famous battlefields. That heritage is embedded in our community's DNA, and it's reflected in our patriotic ceremonies like the one today. Also, in our everyday subconscious, when we send our children to Lane School or to Lieutenant Davis School, when we glance at the sculpture over there, or when we greet and acknowledge friends and coworkers and neighbors who, unknown to us, have resumes that include military service. I want to talk briefly about one of them. Like hundreds of others, he probably won't have a building or a street or a statue bearing his name. And that's really my point. Bedford Fire Lieutenant Mark Casey grew up in Lexington, and he recalled that while a student at Lexington High School, he didn't want to follow the typical path. Indeed, after his junior year, he committed to a four-year enlistment in the Marine Corps. He told me that his senior year, I was excited to get school over with. Mark said he wanted to do what he called the stereotypical Marine thing. So after graduating in 2002, he headed for South Carolina, boot camp at Parris Island, infantry school at Camp Geiger, and soon followed multiple deployments, Iraq, Afghanistan, Iraq again, as well as some time in Japan. Mark was discharged from the active military in 2006 with the rank of sergeant. He returned home, became a Bedford firefighter. Today he lives in Burlington with his wife and their two-year-old. As an NCO, Mark experienced war from the front row seats. But what is especially embedded in his memory are the poverty and deprivation and desperation of the civilians he encountered, men and women, young and old. He was in Fallujah in 2005, he said, and there were open sewers in the streets. In Afghanistan, I saw families living in mud huts. Do these memories enhance his appreciation of the comfort and security of everyday life around here? Without a doubt, Mark said. He continues to support veterans' charities, but there are times when he almost has to remind himself about his military years. Bedford has publicly honored veterans and supporters of veterans for generations. Most of this recognition is bestowed after the subject has passed away. Captain Jonathan Wilson, Congressman Edith North Rogers, Anthony Hunt in Hamilton, Fred Jannetty, Colonel Roy Kirtland, Travis Desiato, and Brian Hart. On Veterans Day, we honor them, but let us also honor hundreds of other veterans that are here with us every day in our neighborhoods, our workplaces, our stores and playgrounds and government agencies. There are Mark Caseys all around us doing their jobs, raising their families, building communities, men and women who serve and who continue to serve.
Thank you, Mike. I would like to introduce our next speaker, our state representative, Ken Gordon.
Thank you, Joe.
Good morning.
Have a good afternoon. And thank you to the Patriotic Holiday Committee for providing me the opportunity to speak with this distinguished group. My wishes for a speedy recovery go out to Paul Perchia. It's a privilege to speak with you and to join my colleague, Senator Mike Barrett, and the select board, Ed Pierce, Mike Rosenberg, Emily Mitchell, Margot Fleischman, and Bill Moonen, Veteran Services Officer Bill Lenahan, and other distinguished guests. And I'm honored to stand with residents of the Bedford Green and to those who are serving at Hanscom Air Force Base. I'm honored to have the safety of our first responders, our police and fire officials who have our backs today. Thank you for the opportunity to pay tribute and thank you as well. And as we just heard, to those who served in the military and come back and then serve with our police and fire as our first responders, those who provide service after service. Today we gather to honor veterans from Bedford, from the Commonwealth, and from around the United States. These brave men and women defended our freedoms and our way of life, and why many of us, why all of us, can do the things that we do today. Expressions of gratitude and symbols of patriotism are important, but the true measure of our society is how we support our veterans and our service members, not just with words, but with deeds. In the words of another wartime hero, former President John F. Kennedy, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to utter words, but to live by them. Here in Massachusetts, by all measures, we are considered a leader in the veteran services we provide. This is the only state where every community has a veteran services officer. Bill Lenahan and Gina Rada do such a wonderful job for us here in Bedford. And in the brief 6 years since I've been serving as your representative in the legislature, we've passed laws that extend protection for veterans at home, in the workplace, and for families. And there's a good reason why we focus on policy that supports our veterans. Veterans give so much back to our business and industry, research, manufacturing, and education. Just look at the campuses at UMass Lowell or Northeastern in Burlington, and you'll find Army and other veteran researchers blazing a path to our future. Veterans are one important reason that this Commonwealth is routinely named the best place to live in the nation. Now, we must also focus on the fact that some veterans, not all veterans, return from service with special needs. Just last week, we in the House unanimously passed legislation that will establish a commission to advise us with regard to the research, treatment, and awareness of PTSD among veterans, and it also provides for the funding and implementation of instruction in our colleges and universities on the unique challenges faced by veterans returning from service and dealing with instances of anxiety, depression, and PTSD. I'm confident the Senate will take up and pass this legislation shortly,
as it has already.
Either it has or I'm sure it's about to. Now, I'd like to indulge your patience for a moment if you've heard me speak before, because there's an important group of veterans right here in this area that are currently addressing instances of anxiety, depression, PTSD, all the way to suicide among veterans. Many of you know that suicide among veterans is at an alarming rate of between 22 per day around this country. And there's a group that began in Burlington called the Skate for the 22. If you've, as I said, if you've been here before, please let this serve as a reminder. And if you haven't been here before, this is an important message. And I'll start off by telling you that just about a year or two ago, I heard from a grandmother in Wilmington who came up to me and said, I heard you talking about the Skate for the 22, and I told my grandson about it. And this is a group of veterans that are there for other veterans, addressing isolation and these instances that lead eventually in some instances to the suicide of veterans. And she told me, she said, my grandson was just, he was in the doldrums. I don't know how to describe it, she said, but he was struggling. And I told him about this group, and he joined this group. He began playing hockey with them. He became a goalie on one of their teams, and it's turned his life around. He has a reason to believe when he wakes up in the morning. And so with that as motivation, I want to tell you a little bit about this group. So it began with maybe a dozen veterans. It began by a veteran of the Army and Air Force named Bobby Colleton, together with an Air Force veteran named Charlie Bobbish. And they had maybe, like I said, a dozen players. They liked playing hockey. It could have been something else. They've now grown to several hundred players. They have teams on the North Shore, the South Shore, in New Hampshire and in Rhode Island. All a veteran has to do is show up. A veteran is already a member of the team. They just have to say that they're here. There's absolutely no charge. There's a Learn to Skate program. I have a cable show running currently where I decided to raise my hand and say, let's see what it's like. And I took my first lesson in the Learn to Skate program. And folks, if I can do it at my age and in the shape I'm in, any of you can do it. You can join. And if you don't want to skate, you can join in other ways as well. If you're not a veteran, please help spread the word. And if you are a veteran, please know that there's a place that for you to go just to hang out. The important part of this program is not necessarily playing hockey. It's the time that the veterans take in the locker room before the games, when they're talking to each other, between periods, and after the games. It's the part where they get together. If someone needs help raking the leaves or addressing something in their home, they get together and they have someone to help. It closely replicates. It's intended to replicate that society that service people have when you're serving, that camaraderie. And so that's what's important about it. Let's begin to address this and turn lives around. And by the way, with respect to the cable show, Senator Barrett and I, I'm sure I'll speak for both of us, would be delighted to come be guests on your show because we can talk about the things that we do.
Oh, absolutely.
Delighted to talk about the things we do at the state level. Now, one more thing I want to tell you about today at Tuscan Kitchen. I'm honored to be able to put into practice the service that I try to do for our community and for our veterans. I'll be serving meals in Burlington Tuscan Kitchen. It's right behind the mall. They started today already. Any veteran of any town, including Burlington, and a guest of that veteran is welcome to come for lunch. They've traditionally served pork roast, a salad. Some of you have been, Bob, you've been, some of you have been already. It's a pork roast, a salad, and a pasta dish, and a dessert. You don't need a reservation. You don't need a ticket. All you need to do is go and say, I'm a veteran. It's a private event, closed to all but that veterans group, so you don't have to say, you know, I want the veterans special or anything like that. You just say, I'm a veteran, they say, welcome. And we're there to serve and are honored to do so. So today until 4 o'clock, please take advantage of that. Folks, it's a special day. Thank you to our veterans, and let's work to make every day Veterans Day so that we never forget the sacrifice that you've given so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we have. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, our state senator, Michael Barrett.
Thank you, Joe. To Paul Persher, who's here with us in spirit, to Chaplain Cooper, Commander O'Connor, Vice Commander Chisholm, Chair Mike Rosenberg, and members of the Board of Select People, and of course, Representative Gordon. I want to say, Commander Chisholm, that I too am happy to be on your TV show as long as you agree not to film us while we try to ice skate. That strikes me as a dangerous combination. I'm the last person who stands between you and a warm room, so I'm going to be extremely brief. This is a serious day, but it needn't be completely a somber one. There is risk for everyone who volunteers to defend this country, and some end up paying a very high cost for serving this nation. But the news is not grim at every turn. There's a great deal of value to serving in our military, something that I want our young people to keep in mind. Report after report among veterans suggest that as difficult as the road can be for some, there is much to be said and much to be had that is rewarding. Last month, in October of 2019, and this is just one indication, I'm happy to report that the unemployment rate for Americans who have been veterans is lower than the unemployment rate for working Americans as a whole. We're lucky, we're all living at a time when unemployment in the United States is at very low levels, but as I say, for those who serve our country, it's lower yet. It's lower for women who serve, it's lower for men who serve. This is a moment, as troubled as it might seem on some fronts, where service to the nation can be personally rewarding despite the risks and the sacrifices. But the speakers who have come before me, and I'm thinking about Representative Gordon in particular, are absolutely right at the same time to stress the work that still needs to be done. The Pew Research Center has interviewed veterans, including veterans who have served since Gulf One, since 1990. 1 in 5 recent vets say that they've struggled with alcohol or substance abuse. About a third have reported that since their discharge and entry into civilian life, they've had trouble paying bills. Roughly 28%, about 1 in 3, have had to resort to unemployment compensation since discharge. So we're actually struck with a complicated picture here. A significant minority of vets struggle, even while for most vets, the reentry to home life has gone reasonably well. They found jobs. They report having received important training for those periods of employment while serving in the military. And they today tell interviewers that their lives are satisfying and happy. What we've got to be sure we're always about, those of us who work in government, is to make certain that this relative good news predominates, and that despite the real sacrifices and risks, we make sure that veterans, as many of them as we can, re-enter American life with the relatively positive reports that the Pew Research Center gives us. You can serve, you can learn, you can grow, and you can come back to an America that appreciates you. That's something, a message we want to get out strongly today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. This next portion of our ceremony, I'm going to ask Debbie Howard, president of the American Legion Auxiliary, and Doris Ruffy to come forward and help us. In this segment, everybody here can come up to the mic and you can make a dedication to a veteran, living or deceased. Mention the person's name, you know, their branch of service, relationship to you, and anything else you would like to say. Started. I want to tell you how this tradition got started. At one of my meetings a dozen years ago, so it was Arjen Rivet who came to the meeting, who was a strong advocate for veterans, and she suggested that we do this. And in the first ceremony, she bought the wreaths and the flags and started this whole thing. Now, Arjen wasn't a veteran, but I think it's only fitting that I would like to dedicate the first flag in her honor and her husband, Roger, who was a World War II POW and Purple Heart recipient. Dedicate a flag.
My father, Marcel Prince, World War II, Korean War.
Army Lieutenant General Robert McAllister, my late father.
Joe's great-grandfather, Bernard Anthony Pantidosi, and Joseph Richard Pantidosi, we honor you. Thanks for serving as a Vietnam era veteran.
My late brother, Air Force Colonel Robert Schott, Special Forces, Air Commando, East Asian Theater, etc.
My late father, Ed Felker, U.S. Air Force, 1963 to 1967.
Frank LaShane Jr., Chief, United States Navy, Seabees.
Yes.
Douglas LaShane, Sergeant, United States Marine Corps. Jeffrey Sharp, Sergeant, United States Marine Corps.
My grandfather's.
Richard Madden served in the Marines in World War II, and also my friends Major Kate and Major Kevin Adams, who served in Iraq and now serving in Afghanistan.
My father, Sam Massey, Battle of the Bulge, he was in Germany in the tank.
My late uncle, Joseph Scotchell, who lost his life on a submarine serving in World War II, and my late dad, John Bluma, who served in the Air Force during the Korean conflict.
I'd like to remember my father, Nancy, from World War II, and my father, Mark Purchin, from World War II, and my husband, Paul Purchin.
I'd like to honor my husband, John R. Monahan, Sergeant Major, retired Army National Guard, and also the Air Force, and everything he does for veterans all the time.
In honor of my grandfather, John Cork, U.S. Navy, World War II, USS Wasp.
My father, Nathan Perdue, got deployed to the Marines.
I'd like to honor my late father, Paul Metcalf, Korean War veteran, and my late father-in-law, Malcolm Weatherby, who's a 20-year Air Force veteran.
I'd like to recognize my mother, United States Navy, and my father, both United States Navy.
My great-grandfather, Gerald Mattson, U.S. Navy, World War II.
I'd like to recognize my father, James Noble, my uncle, John Helms, my great-grandfather, Gordon, my grandfather, William.
I
Herbert Herman Jr. He was a sergeant in Cleveland. First sergeant. Now it's Saber Mail.
I'd like to honor my grandfather, Anthony Rickey, and my late relatives, Edward Rickey, Luke Sewell, and Pete Fabs.
My great grandpa, Metro Mitchell, U.S. Army, World War II.
My great grandfather, who served on USS Missouri, BB-63 in the Korean War.
My grandfather, John.
Grandfather Alex Bro, who was in the Navy.
I'd like to recognize my World War II vets, Grandfather Wayne Meredith, U.S. Navy, and Uncle Walter Mercier, U.S. Army.
My father, William Hurley, Specialist in the Army.
My grandfather, Frank Wood, U.S. Army, World War II. And my dear friend, Michelle Feedback, U.S. Army, Counterintelligence, Iraq and Afghanistan. I'm remembering my grandfather, Alfred F. Giuliano, who served in France during World War I in the 78th Lightning Division, Allied Expeditionary Forces.
Recognizing my two grandfathers who served in World War II in the U.S. Army, and my father, Ed Hammond, who's a retired lieutenant colonel of the United States Army and served in Vietnam.
I'd like to recognize my late husband, who was a sergeant first class in the Army in Korea, 1951 to 1953. My two brother-in-laws, Roland Pomponi, in the Air Force, and my brother-in-law Tony Pomponi was in the Navy, and my brother-in-law Neil Wicker was in the Navy too.
I'd like to honor and offer best wishes to my son, Austin O'Connor, U.S. Army, who along with his two grandparents, now making Austin the third generation.
I'd like to recognize to my son, Vincent Welsh, who is a lieutenant colonel in the United States Marine Corps, serving right now at the Pentagon, but he has served in Iraq and Afghanistan.
I would like to honor my dad, who served in the Marines for a while. He was a colonel.
Hi, I'm honored for my friend, Pearl Harbor survivor, Jim Coleman, and also my father-in-law, Donegan, serving the U.S. Marine Corps.
I'd like to honor my twin brother, the United States Air Force Vietnam veteran, and also my dear friend James Alexander Daly, who writes the book A Hero's Welcome. The United States, he was a POW for 6.5 years in Vietnam.
And I would like to honor two deceased veterans. First, Nick Giannetti, a former member of our committee who fought in Iwo Jima and was a Purple Heart recipient, and Gordon Feltman, who retired from the U.S. Air Force and was a fellow selectman who served many years in the town. next item we have is a patriotic sing-along, God Bless America, the music by the high school marching band. In closing, I would like to thank a lot of people today who made this event possible, starting with Jim Felker and our high school marching band, who did a wonderful job as usual. Hanscom 66 Security Force Squadron, who provided two of our airmen who are firing squad, Eric Bone and Kendra Play, and also two other veterans who are members of the Woodland Sportsman's Association, who are part of our rifle squad, John Picora, Joe Solo. our Public Works Department, particularly our grounds crew, Danny Freeman, who do a great job always setting up our ceremonies. The Veteran American Legion and VFW are both members, along with the women from the VFW and American Legion Auxiliary help us with this last part of our ceremony. And our Patriotic Holiday Committee, Paul Purchett, who's our chair, couldn't be here today due to recovering from a medical issue, but he certainly participated in helping with the planning of this whole event. And the other members of the committee, John Monahan, O.C. O'Connor, Bobby Ennis, John Cooper, Barbara Percher, and James Burke. And to all of you, thank you for coming and helping us honor our veterans. And lastly, I want to say that everyone is invited for lunch at the American Legion Post in VFW, which is also now VFW Post, so with that, thank you.